Welcome to today's webinar with NCWIT and the DoD STEM. We are going over the DoD STEM Ambassadors program. So super excited to have you here and participating with us today. So in today's meeting, we are going to cover all things DoD STEM Ambassadors program. We are going to hear from three ambassadors who have participated in the program and learn about their experiences. You're going to have an opportunity to ask them your questions and just to get whatever information you need. So definitely take advantage of this. It's a really amazing program. Excited for you to hear about it. We will be moderated today by Eric Moore, who is the Vice President of TGR Foundation, and you'll hear more from him in just a moment. But first, I want to tell you a little bit about NCWIT. So the National Center for Women and Information Technology is a nonprofit community of more than 1,300 universities, companies, nonprofits, government organizations nationwide. The theory of change is that NCWIT convenes, equips, and unites all of our change leader organizations so that they can increase the influential and meaningful participation of girls and women at every intersection of race, ethnicity, class, age, gender identity, sexual orientation, disability, everything. And we want them to be able to participate influentially in the field of computing and technology, particularly as it concerns innovation and development. NCWIT's community is kind of like an ecosystem of change leaders. And our ecosystem is comprised of programs and initiatives that span the women's entire journey from K-12, honestly pre-K, through the career into the workforce and beyond. We're even looking at post-workforce and retirement and everything. So we are across the entire lifespan of women technologists. We have awards programs like our Aspirations in Computing program. We have professional development for teachers, counselors, and other technologists. And we have workforce initiatives and tools and resources that can be used to advance whatever mission and whatever effort that is around computing and increasing access to technology and computer science. NCWIT is currently the farthest reaching network of change leaders such like we are that is focused on advancing innovation by correcting underrepresentation in computing. So it would be remiss if we did not say we would not be here today without the support from our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM. This is the largest employer of scientists and engineers across the nation. DoD STEM offers a number of educational programs, internships, scholarships, and such for students, and many career development opportunities for educators and other STEMologists. I just made that word up, y'all. So we've shared their website, and I will also send it out to you all post this meeting so you can learn more about the opportunities and the work that's being done with this pretty cool partnership. NCWIT is a part of DoD STEM's DSEC, it's Defense STEM Education Consortium. This is 27 members, and it's a collaborative partnership, and they have academia, industry, nonprofit, government, again, across all sectors, all focused on broadening STEM literacy and developing a diverse and agile workforce for the future of the United States and to power our innovative defense infrastructure. NCWIT has been a part of this initiative for over 5 years. And so we really value the work that we're doing with them. And we're excited to offer this workshop in collaboration with them. So I'm going to pass it over to Eric, who will take off talking about the program. And Eric, whenever you're ready to advance, just say next slide.
Great. Thank you so much, Brittany. And really grateful and honored to be here partnering here with NCWIT to talk about the Ambassador Program. So I'm going to spend the next few minutes just kind of giving a kind of high-level overview of what the program is and some of the components there. This is we're currently in the third year of the DoD STEM Ambassador Program. We're wrapping up at the end of August, so we're getting close to towards the end. So it's a relatively new program that came out of this DSEC consortium that Brittany was talking about, right? So, and I should probably back up. So I am Eric Moore, Vice President of Programs, and I'm with TGR Foundation, right? And so TGR Foundation, we manage and facilitate the program on behalf of DoD STEM. So if you are selected as an ambassador, you will see a lot of me in the future. But so the ambassador program, it's really grounded in some of the DSEC fundamentals, and it might be a little blurry on your screen, but you know, those fundamentals are aligned to the federal STEM goals, and they talk about engaging students in meaningful STEM experiences, connecting to DoD STEM workforce, serving students who are underrepresented in STEM or military connected, and then leveraging the network as a force multiplier. It is a yearly cohort, so it kind of follows the academic year in a sense. So it's a September to August kind of time frame of K to 16 STEM educators, and that really does run the range. We have educators that are college professors, we have educators at elementary school and up and down. We have educators in the classroom, we have educators out of the classroom, kind of in more district level roles or coaching roles and that sort of thing. This year we have 22 ambassadors, and we're continuing to grow. We're gonna have closer to 30 next year, right? So the program continues to grow. So the program's there to kind of do four main things, broadly speaking, right? So bringing high quality STEM learning experiences to students, especially those that are military connected or underrepresented, promoting DoD STEM opportunities and access. There's a whole world of DoD STEM programs out there that a lot of folks just don't know exists, right? And so part of the program is just helping educators understand and get connected to some of these programs so that they can, you know, hopefully bring them to their classroom with their students or their communities, because there's a lot out there, a lot of it's free, a lot of it's really good. And it's really about connecting students to kind of opportunities, get them on pathways to STEM careers. We're there to help recognize and empower STEM educators, right? We're big believers in the work that you all do, and we want to recognize and empower that work that you do on the ground. And then finally, leveraging the network to amplify. So NCWIT will have a STEM ambassador next year. In addition to all those little icons, the logos you saw on the previous slide, most of the DSEC organizations next year, they each nominate their own STEM ambassador. So it's a cohort of folks from the different organizations from around the country, even around the world, that come together. They network, we share opportunities and resources so that we can kind of spread kind of the good work that's happening around the country and use that to sort of leverage that work. There is, we encourage you to go to the website there. If you just type in DoD STEM ambassadors in Google, it should pop up. You'll see some of the panelists we have here today, current and previous ambassadors there. But it'll give you a sense on who the folks are and where they're coming from. Next slide, please. Okay, so here's my poorly done map of this is you'll see, so the ambassadors come, we're in year three right now, they come from across the country. There are some locations that you might know as kind of stand out. The DMV is a fairly prominent location for a lot of reasons. There's a lot of programs in the DMV area. DoD STEM has a big presence in that area, so that's pretty obvious. But you'll see there's quite a big reach there. And we do have one ambassador this year who's at a Dodea High School out in Germany as well. So you'll see his little green dot over there. So we hope to continue this, and I would love to get ambassadors from some of those regions that we haven't yet been in contact with. We want to make sure that we're touching rural areas, urban areas, and then everywhere in between. Next slide, please. So a bit more about the program details. Okay, so we do, so professional development, we provide professional development, or we partner with other organizations to bring professional development. Focused on some of the domains prioritized in the federal STEM strategic plan. Those include things like computational literacy or inquiry-based learning or transdisciplinary learning, workforce development, and so forth. So we come together and kind of go through some sessions on those topics. Each ambassador is tasked with presenting at a regional or national conference. And so that can be a conference of their choice. And the idea being, as a DoD STEM ambassador, if you're out there at these conferences and people know you're a DoD STEM ambassador, and maybe you share opportunities and resources in the DoD STEM world, it helps the visibility and that sort of thing of DoD STEM. Each ambassador is tasked with writing a blog post that is featured on the DoD STEM website and shared more widely than that. And then all ambassadors go through something what we call impact projects, which essentially taking a lot of this information, a lot of resources, and doing something with it, right? So what can you do with that? How can you make an impact? How can you leverage some of those opportunities or some of the partnerships that you've made to make an impact on the ground? The award funding is laid out there. So it's a part of the award is a $12,500 stipend for your time in the program throughout the year. And it's not an insignificant amount of time. You are awarded $5,000 toward the purchase of STEM supplies. And then $2,500 is set aside for you to attend a conference. So for travel, registration, and those sort of costs, right? So that's the breakdown of the award funding. And then I get questions quite often in terms of the time commitment. And I will say it does vary, but we do meet, ambassadors meet virtually monthly, once per month on a Saturday for 3 hours, right? So we take a chunk out of your weekend once per month. Each ambassador, we encourage them to work with their host organization throughout the year. So for example, if it's NCWIT, you might work close with NCWIT on a variety of projects, nothing too extraneous, maybe up to 4 hours per month, but again, that can vary. And then additional tasks and requirements, like for example, writing a blog post or doing the impact project or doing some of the other things that we ask in the program could take another 3 hours per month. So you're looking at a maximum, maybe 10 hours per month time commitment. But again, that can vary quite significantly. You know, the months of December, January, you see a lull, right? And then there might be other months where there's more time committed to the program. Okay, so I think that'll cover, I think a lot more information will bubble up during the next piece. So I'm gonna shift just slightly here to introduce our panelists today. And actually I'm gonna have them introduce themselves. I'm not gonna talk about them. So first up, Mayra, if you wanna go ahead and introduce yourself and let folks know which cohort you are a part of.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Mayra Ramos. I am with CGEST out of Arizona State University, the Center of Gender Equity in Science and Technology. I am currently a seventh and eighth grade math, science, and STEM teacher. That they emphasize math and science. I'm moving actually into the government position actually in New Mexico this coming year, but I'm taking my impact project, which is we started as a small idea and actually moving it into reality in my new position outside of Arizona. So nice to see everyone here.
Great, thank you so much. Next up, Lisa.
Hello everyone, it's great to be here with you. It has been a real honor to work with the TGR Foundation as my sponsor as a DoD STEM ambassador. And I've been told once an ambassador, always an ambassador. So I am a cohort 2 member. I've been through the full cycle and have just really appreciated the opportunity. My planning for impact project was, I think I need to back up. I didn't introduce myself either fully. I'm the director of STEM programs for Watertown City School District, which is a district that serves about 4,000 students in Northern New York. We are attached to Fort Drum. And when you think Northern New York, I mean Northern. I live 4 miles from the Canadian border. So I like to say almost Canada. But this partnership has brought so many opportunities to my region through all of the connections. The DSEC partners have so many opportunities available in addition to the opportunities directly through DoD. So I think anybody who's thinking about applying, really look at all the opportunities. It's a phenomenal experience. My planning for impact project, because I'm connected with a military installation, I really was interested in exploring the communications and connections between school districts and military installations, because that can be challenging at times. And there are a lot of benefits to doing that. So many great opportunities for our students. So that's what I focused on for my project. And my blog post was on making that artificial AI real in K-12 education, looking at the role of artificial intelligence in our schools. So again, I really appreciate this opportunity. I became connected to the opportunity through a colleague in STEM ecosystems. If you're familiar with STEM learning ecosystems, it's actually one of Eric Moore's colleagues that Guy LaBelle said, hey, Lisa, I think you should get connected to this. I think this would be a great opportunity for you. So here I am, just really honored to be here and thankful for all of the great people I've been fortunate to work with as a result.
Thank you so much, Lisa. And last but certainly not least, Michelle.
All right, I'm sorry for the delay. I have my granddaughter was watching a movie which was gonna come through my audio, so I just paused it. Anyway, I'm Michelle Ming. I am the Director of Engineering, Program Director of Project Lead the Way Engineering at Archbishop Carroll High School in Washington, DC. I have my host organization is TIES, or Teaching Institute of Excellence in STEM. And so my connection to TIES was kind of unexpected, in that Morgan State University, one of their tenured professors is Professor Jesse Talley, who happens to be an alum of Archbishop Carroll. So when I started the engineering program, she became part of the advisory board of my engineering program. And as a result of her becoming a member of that, we've worked together closely, and she nominated me for this position in connection with Morgan, which is a DSEC partner, and TIES. So I was interviewed by TIES, and one of the people who was interviewing me was just adorable. Her name is Toby Bethel. And I met Toby years ago at the Naval Academy STEM program called Set Sail. And it's a PD program, it was grant oriented, it's free, it's an amazing program. They have a waiting list forever. And it's at our Naval Academy in Annapolis, Maryland. And I actually have gone multiple times and worked with Toby, but I had no idea that she was with TIES. So it was really a great surprise. As far as my impact, you know, Eric and I have talked about the fact that this Saturday is when we're going to be talking about that more in depth. However, I did begin to discuss with the professor who is my mentor at Catholic University of America about a program called REACH. We want to partner together to find community candidates who need our help. So we're going to be spearheading that. We're looking at the VA, we're looking at a soldier's home and a national rehabilitation centers, which are near and in somewhat walking distance to Carroll, to see how we can serve those communities and engineer solutions for those to increase their mobility. So that the moment, that's what we're working on. I'm also working on continuing to expand dual enrollment opportunities for my students. Right now, they can go to Catholic University of America for free, one engineering course, and assuming they pass it, which they do, they will receive 3 engineering credits that are transferable to other schools. And that has been widely wanted and successful over the past 4 years. And so we're looking to expand that to other universities. So I'm in talks with Howard University, which is also near us, and some other universities that would be willing to work with our school.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Michelle. Okay, so let's dive in. A few questions here for each of the ambassadors. I'm gonna go back to the top here to Mayra. Can you describe how did you get connected to your host organization, and what made you want to apply to the program?
Because I am a school teacher currently in the classroom, literally left an hour ago, we have a lot of universities that would like to come and work with our school. We're a Title I school. One of them was Arizona State University, and I work really close with Dr. Jordan, who is the photovoltaics educator out of Arizona State, and she brought in an assistant. And it was that assistant who, whenever this ambassador thing that I was like, what are you talking about, an ambassador thing? She emailed me one day and she's like, hey, I think this would be perfect for you. What do you think? And I originally deleted the email because I was like, I don't know what she's talking about. I don't really care, whatever. And then she called me on the phone and she said, this is going to be perfect for you. And she talked a little bit about it. I applied. There was quite a few people that applied, went through the interview with Dr. Tara Nukurma out from Arizona State and was chosen. And again, it was one of those, what did I get myself into? But it was one of those, they were already coming into my classroom. They already kind of knew my name here and there. And I was chosen to apply. I wasn't chosen for the job itself or the position itself, but definitely was given the opportunity, which I am incredibly thankful for. So that's how I got pinged into this, and I love it.
Great. And for Lisa and Michelle, I think we kind of already heard a little bit about your background and applying there. So I'm just going to shift the question now to Lisa. Since you're the only alum on this panel, because Michelle and Mayra are currently in it, maybe we'll start with you. So what would you say are some of the key benefits from participating in the STEM Ambassador program and your ongoing engagement in the program?
I would say one of the very first things was the shock and awe at all of the opportunities available through DoD STEM. And I see Michelle and Mayra both nodding their heads, because when we first dove in one of our early meetings into looking at what was available, there were so many opportunities there for students. And I'm always looking for opportunities for my students, being in a rural, geographically isolated area, you know, and military connected. I'm always trying to find things for students. And there were a lot of things that I didn't know about. So that is, I would say, one of the most amazing benefits. And TGR Foundation being one of the partners, if you haven't seen all of the
connection up in rural upstate New York might be a
The other thing that I would like to add is that the connections you make, all of the partnerships with, you know, each other within the ambassador group and organizations, they just, it's force multiplier, right? You make one connection and it leads to so many more connections and opportunities that just multiply across the board. And it brought so many great things to students and to my staff in my region. So always grateful. Thanks.
So you cut off there in a second, I think, during your most important part around TGR Foundation, but that's okay. That's okay.
About TGR and all the great training for teachers and opportunities for students.
Yeah, thanks for that shout out. Okay, I'm going to throw it over to Michelle. Same question. If there's anything you would like to expand on or add to what Lisa was saying, just from your experience, what are some of the benefits from your current participation in the DoD STEM Ambassador Program?
So similar to the other two here, although I'm not military connected, our school, even though it is a faith-based school, it's a Catholic school, but we are the only Catholic school in our area that takes opportunity scholarship program vouchers, which are people who qualify for that, families who qualify for that are sitting at the poverty level and qualify for free or reduced lunch. So we are actually a Title I school, even though we are a private school. And as a result of the efforts that we do to fulfill our mission to reach that community, we need as much support and as many resources as possible. And so DSEC has provided a ton of resources and opportunities for our kids. And then in addition to that, the fact that I, as part of this, need to go to conferences, I chose to go to the International Technology and Engineering Educators Association conference. And I was able to be a showcase presenter there on behalf of DoD STEM and Project Lead the Way and my school. And I just made a million connections. It was so impactful. And people asking me lots of questions, well, what is DoD and what is DoD STEM? I had the opportunity to really talk about all of the resources and spread the wealth, because it is a lot, but I would have never gone to that conference if this wasn't part of being a DoD STEM ambassador. And I really appreciate kind of the push, right, to go into these different spaces that I wouldn't necessarily have gone on my own.
And then Mayra, I want to make sure you have an opportunity to answer that as well. Anything to add and for benefits of being in the program?
I will definitely say the same thing like the other two said, the connections. I've been able to, so because we are Title I, we're such a small school, we're a small district in Arizona, we get, you know, passed on for everything. And I've been able to bring in programs that DoD STEM has to offer into Phoenix, into not only my district, but different districts. And then the conference travel, that has been eye-opening because now I have people, I know people by first names that I wouldn't have ever known. There's a conference that I've always wanted to go to, and because the funding is there, because we have the opportunity, because we're pushed, I'm actually able to go. And I laugh about it because I jokingly said it to Eric when we were in DC, and I said, I'm gonna go to London, and I'm going to London. So that's, I'm like, yeah. But you know, there's also IEEE, they're actually seeking us out now to do conferences. So I just get random emails like, would you like to talk about this or that? And it's like, yeah, sure, I'll go. You're gonna get the bill, but why not? So it's definitely been a benefit. And on top of that, my family has benefited from it, my son. So when we met in DC, I had talked to Eric about scholarships for my son. He's starting college next year. And I needed some ideas on different scholarships, things like that. And he made his decision late. So he missed on a lot of scholarships, and he's been able to apply and get some of these scholarships. So not only did my school benefit, but my family personally benefited from being in DoD.
Great, snaps to that, that's wonderful. Okay, a similar question, but I think I wanna shift the focus here. So how has being in the program and being maybe in this DSEC or DoD STEM world, how has it had like a tangible impact on the students you work with or the students you serve? Or the educators that you serve? And I think I might throw it to Michelle, because you did in the chat mention the TIE STEM on the go band. So I think that might be something to at least to start with. So what are some of those things that you're seeing on the ground and the students that you work with?
Yeah, so I knew nothing about STEM on the go band. Come to find out, it's a TIE's initiative. And they basically bring to you a van that has fabricators, fabrication machines, 3D printers, and they create a project that the students will participate in. At my school, one of the things that I'm kind of tasked with is to bridge the gap between engineering, science, and math at our school, because we're all kind of in our own individual silos. And as a result, we need to collaborate, but it's been really difficult. And so one of the things STEM on the Go did for me was it gave me an opportunity to bridge the chemistry class and my intro to engineering design class, which is 3D modeling. We were able to build a pop rocket with a projectile that they had to build using PVC pipe and construction paper and 2-liter empty bottle, and it had a blast. And they really enjoyed it. I was able to pull in multiple teachers who normally don't work together on these types of projects, and they could see the benefit. They saw our students doing things that they don't normally assume that they can do or would want to do. And so it was a fantastic experience, and I'm really glad that I had that opportunity and probably wouldn't have been exposed to it had I not been a STEM ambassador.
Wonderful. Yeah, and that's just one of the many, many sort of partners in this DSEC world. So let me shift that to Mayra. Any specific programs or opportunities for your students that they would speak to?
When we came back from the STEM Exchange in Washington, D.C., I had gone through one of the sessions about math counts, and I brought it up to my principal, and he's like, wait, they do this? And I was like, yeah, they have this program, you know, let's talk a little bit about it. We tested it. They have like this like 2-week testing. And then he asked me to present it to our board. And so our district is doing it. Now the two neighboring districts near us are also doing it as well. So they are in Arizona. They're just not in the populations that we serve. And we wanted to make sure we brought that in. And so that's one of like 1,000 that are happening. I just had a meeting earlier about all the other opportunities. I actually have to keep a list now, when before it was like, well, I think we have $100 for this. Now it's, these programs want to help, and there are opportunities for it to be cost efficient for our districts who are low income.
Wonderful. And then finally, Lisa, I want to make sure you have a chance to answer too.
Well, I just found it was really interesting. I put something in the chat. All three of us work with Title I schools. So my district in Northern New York is, we're in the lowest 1% in per pupil funding. So these opportunities and resources available are game changers for our communities and for our students, for our teachers as well. You know, I think about all of the professional learning opportunities that have been provided through, I mentioned TGR Foundation already, but also things, supplies for my STEM camp and training teachers. So we've gotten things like Strawbees building kits and data bots, which we can connect with Velcro, small sensors that attach to drones, and we can gather data in real time and share it out on the screen and have real meaningful discussions about real math with our students, real meaningful, relevant, you know, connections to data analysis. So I'm just, all of these things, were it not for the opportunities that I've had through DoD STEM, and I also work with the DODEA, which is the Department of Defense Educational Activity Grants Program, because we are a military-connected district. Were it not for these opportunities, we'd really be, you know, when I first started in the area, I felt like I walked back in time. It's a different place in time, and our kids need better. And so thank you for making it possible for us to do better for our students.
No, I see your hand is up.
Yeah, I just wanted to add two cool things that happened. One, we were able to buy drones. And so we are actually competing in a drone competition in Pennsylvania on Saturday. We're very excited. My students, our population is about 80% African American, about 18% or so Latino. And so my drone team is mixed. I've got two Latino students and three African-American students and one actually who's from Africa. And it's so cool to see them working together on the same thing. I was able to get a sponsor to get us to the drone competition so that we could afford to go, which was amazing. Now, when I was at that conference I talked to you all about and I had this showcase, I showed off the data bot, right? And this person had never seen it. And they are a professor at a college or university. And they were looking for something small enough to collect data and to provide statistics. And so they're going to buy a data bot. They wanted to know more about it. And I was also able to put the data bot on our pop rocket to do acceleration and elevation and some other stuff when the STEM van came. So like data bot has been a game changer for me in my curriculum because we definitely use sensors, but it's so easy to use. And so I'm so glad you turned us on to that. These are cool resources, and I'm so glad I have that opportunity.
Great, and I should mention, we are dumping a lot of like information on you and all these things, but I think the point of it, we're not there to say, you must do this, you must do this, you must do this. It's really to expose you to these programs and opportunities, and you're able to be like, oh, that looks interesting. I wanna grab and take that, or that looks interesting. This person looks interesting, let me connect to this person. So it really is tailored to what you need, and just making sure you're aware of what's out there and they give you the resources and then the support to make it happen in the classroom, right? So just wanna make sure that that's clear. Okay, so a couple more questions here. I'm gonna start with Mayra here. So looking back, is there anything that you wish you would have known about the program before applying?
I really don't think I wish there like something that I would have known. I think one of the things that was a game changer for me was meeting some of the previous ambassadors. So I was connected to an ambassador out of San Diego, and him and I have now become really good friends, and we're not even in the same cohort, but he's helped me through some of the projects that we're doing. And then we're trying to figure out ways on how to collaborate because he knows that I'm leaving my current position going somewhere else. But that would, you know, if that would have been something from the get-go, I feel like it would have opened more of those doors and more understanding of what am I even doing here? So it's just that, but there's everything else has been so straightforward. The direction, you know, the advice, or just the availability of you, Eric, and everybody else. It's just, it's been so easy to just kind of walk through and go, all right, this is where I'm lost. Please find me. So it's been good.
Great. And I'm actually going to shift the question here. I'm going to throw a curveball to Lisa. Would you have any sort of advice for folks who aren't really sure about the program, haven't heard of DoD STEM, and they're thinking about applying? Any sort of advice of what you suggest if they do apply and are accepted, to kind of how to take advantage of the program?
So I guess one of the things, you know, as I've talked to some of my friends from the program, from my cohort, is we engaged in so many different types of projects. Like, I'm sure Mayra and Michelle, that you've found the same thing. Your projects are very different, right? Just kind of having an idea of what the different DSEC partners, what their roles are and kind of what they are looking for in terms of projects, or what they might be interested in, that would be interesting. One of the things I think sometimes people are scared of getting involved in a program like this, because they think, I don't have the time, I'm teaching full time, I'm doing all these things. Well, this kind of, it folds into what you do, I would say. And it energizes you, provides resources to support what you do. And Eric and Jessica Kessler, who has been his partner in this work of leading the ambassadors, have done a really terrific job of making sure that we know what our responsibilities are, when they're due. We know where to go for support. They set us up really nicely to work together in partnerships, so you never feel like you're alone. So I think they've done a terrific job of structuring this. So if you are concerned about any of those things that I mentioned, know that you're in very good hands with their leadership.
Wow. Okay, that's really nice to hear. Okay.
Did I answer it?
Yeah, I need you guys, like I need a pep talk on the daily weeks of the year. Okay, so I might. So speaking of the time commitment piece, so I know that there's some hesitancy there, right? We know that the most valuable resource of a teacher is time. So I'm going to ask you, Michelle, you know, we do meet on Saturdays and there's stuff to do. And so how do you juggle, or what would you say in terms of like the time commitment for folks that are sort of on the fence here?
I feel like the 3 hours that we meet, and first of all, I want to say, agree with Lisa, that you and Jessica give us the ability to know exactly what it is we're being tasked to do, what our end goal is in 3 hours. And you're very true to the time. You respect our time. You respect the effort that we put in to be there on a Saturday. So I think it's a really wonderful fit, you know. Plus I gain, because we're having presentations, we're learning about new DSEC partners in that 3 hours. That I can take away and actually use in my classroom. Like the DataBot presentation, learned a lot and was able to use it in my classroom. So it helps me, you know? And so the fact that it's only one day a month, that's fantastic.
Great. Okay, so we're coming close to time here. I do wanna ask, just because shifting this a little bit, So those of you who are joining us today, you know, maybe considering applying for the ambassador program, where NCWIT would be your host organization, right? So I wanted to ask Mayra, because your host this would be NCWIT's first STEM ambassador. So we're really excited about that. But Mayra, you your host organization is ASU CGEST, which I'll let you make sure I'm a center for. You should say it. But can you just talk a little bit about how you worked with ASU CGEST and sort of how that partnership worked? Because not only is there this ambassador program and us at the cohort meeting together, but you also are kind of tied to your host organization doing some separate things, right? Can you talk a little bit about that?
So it's the Center of Gender Equity in Technology, CGEST, Science and Technology, sorry. So one of the, immediately when I was first hired, I had a meeting with everybody on the team, and it was the most beautiful meeting I've ever had, which is really weird for a teacher to say. It was 12 people, and they literally said, "We're here for anything you need, anything you want, just let us know." And so it started with simple tasks. You know, we would go back and forth about what students need in schools, and they're always doing some kind of research. And so quickly they were in my classroom. They're like, "Hey, what can we do to help you in your classroom? What do your kids need?" So that to me was just already like, whoa, why you guys want to help me, my kids? And then we decided that we were going to have weekly meetings. So every Monday morning before school starts, I meet with somebody on my team. So it's usually the assistant that I told you guys about that kind of brought me in, or my boss. But we have these weekly meetings, and one of the tasks that we decided we would do together is I love to write. And so they have this ongoing newsletter that goes out every month. And so every month, whatever the subject is, I write a small article, and it could be like a simple 100 words, 200 words, whatever it is. One time I wrote about my mom. They wanted me to write about where I came from, and so I wrote about my mom. But they have all of these articles that eventually I can put as a yearly blog, because it does continue with everything that's happening. They also know that I have certain ties to my community, and they wanted to hear about that. So it depends. And then it's funny, because right before we started, Dr. Nakorma, she texted me, and she was like, "Hey, you're doing this. Can I see it? What can I do?" But they're always there. They're always there to support. But we do pretty much just open communication every time after we have our STEM ambassador meeting. The next Monday, we will meet and debrief, and they help me through everything. So there's even our blog post. I sent it to them, and I was like, does this sound okay? Is it okay? And they gave me their, you know, editing and all of that, all of their feedback. And it's been great. And one of the discussions that we recently had this past Monday, I told them, in August, that's it. And they told me, they're like, "No, it's not. You're going to be our ambassador forever." And I was like, "Oh, that's the best thing ever." But they also know my family, which is even weird. They know my son. They know my husband. It honestly becomes this huge family, and you just don't let go of that, you know, and it's been great.
That's wonderful. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to finish with this last question. So taking this ambassador program, you're either in it right now or you weren't in it. How do you see it helping support you long term, right? Mayra, you just kind of mentioned that you're part of the CGS family for life, and obviously the ambassador program. So how do you see this kind of being more than just a 1 year program? And if I could just ask you, keep the answer relatively short, because I want to make sure to be respectful of folks' time. I should pick Lisa. Go ahead.
I think the biggest thing is the connections. The connections stay with us, and we are all, I think, you know, we already noticed that connection of Title I schools. We're here to serve our communities, and this is, it's a life of service that we've chosen in the work that we do. And this opportunity and all these connections just help us be more effective in that service that we wish to provide our communities in STEM education, because we know it's important for our workforce of the future and for the well-being of our communities.
Well said. Michelle, how do you see this long-term?
Well, it's my goal to connect to as many DSEC partners as I can. Because I want to give my students opportunities. There's internships, there's summer programs, there's scholarships, there's lots of things. So I intend to be reaching out as much as I can. And so that's one of the ways that I see that. Plus, I want to reach out to Morgan State more and Toby, and they've all told me that once you're a STEM ambassador, you're a STEM ambassador for life.
And Mayra, last word, if you want one, just in terms of long-term, how do you see this ambassador program supporting your work?
In every way, because I am a classroom teacher, and now I have all these, I have a network of people, a network of resources that I am using, not only at my school, but my goal is to, since I get to work for the government next year, to bring that into New Mexico and Arizona and hopefully beyond that.
Eric, I just wanted to frame this too. Even though my title is program director, I actually teach 5 engineering courses. I teach all of Project Lead the Way courses, and they're all different. And as a classroom teacher, it has been par none, really, as far as comparison to the type of resources that I've had in the past and the support that I have now. It's awesome.
So I do want to take a quick moment here. Oh, Lisa, I see your hand raised.
There's a question about needing to be Title I. I think I just mentioned that because I found it interesting that we were all serving high needs communities. The question is if you must be a Title I school district to be involved as an ambassador, and that is not a need. It's just, I think it drives some of the work that we do, and we just happen to be connected in that.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that. So it's definitely not a requirement. You know, one of the components of the program is that we are serving underrepresented populations in STEM and or military connected. So it certainly helps. I think if those populations are a part of your sphere of influence, but it's not there's no hard and fast line there. And so not all of our ambassadors teach at a Title I school, right? Not all of them do. And how many, another question here, how many host organizations are there? So next year we're gonna have 26 host organizations, right? So NCWIT being one of them, TGR Foundation being one, and then 24 others, including a handful of branches of the military, right? So the Army, Navy, Air Force will each have an ambassador and a few other DoD kind of STEM related agencies as well. So we continue to expand. Okay, so I want to take this time to, we can't see everyone, but I'm sure you're all going to give a round of applause just like I am here. But so thank you so much to Lisa, Michelle, and Mayra for your words. I'm really grateful to be part of this and to help shepherd these amazing educators and just get them what they need to excel on the ground and to work with students and teachers. So I'm going to finish here by just kind of going over a few more details with the application process for those of you that are interested in applying for the program and selecting NCWIT as your host organization. So I believe that's the next slide, Brittany, if you'll mind. Okay, so here's the process. The application is now open. It is live. The deadline to apply, I think we're at the 3-week mark or so May 30th. 11:59 p.m. Eastern time is the deadline to apply. And there is the link there with the QR code. There is one single application. So all 26 host organizations are using the same link. So if you're interested in applying, we encourage you to select NC, because one of the questions towards the bottom will ask you which host, what's your sponsoring organization? And so NCWIT would be your selection. If you notice, there are organizations on the list, and just to give an example, because Michelle was talking about TIES quite a bit. So let's say you've worked with TIES or part of the STEM ecosystem network, and maybe you want to choose TIES as your sponsoring organization. You're welcome to do that. So each organization will review applications separately and make their selection. And then that person that selected will join the cohort next year. The selections will be made by June 30th, and the notifications will be sent shortly thereafter. The program will start in September. Our first session together will be Saturday, September 16th. There will be some, besides the notifications that are sent out, if you are accepted to the program, we'll be asking you to share some paperwork and things like that so we can start processing your award payments early. But our first time together officially will be in September, and we'll run through August of 2024. Let me just make sure. Okay, so I got a question here. Can you apply more than once with more than one organization? So the answer there is, that's actually a good question. So I think the answer would be yes, that you can, because each organization will just see the applications they receive from folks that selected them, right? So let's say you're connected to a couple organizations. I would encourage you to select more than once, but they require a separate application and make sure the answers are appropriate for the questions that are being asked.
Eric, I wanted to see if you could address the, because we keep saying ambassador for life, but truth is we are a cohort for a school year. And then beyond that, you know, the stipend doesn't go. I think maybe we need to explain all that.
Yeah, right. So yeah, the award funding is doled out throughout the academic year. And in addition to the supplies for the $5,000 in supply funding and the $2,500 for travel, that all takes place within the year. There will be, if you are an ambassador, there will be additional opportunities once you sort of graduate from the program to apply for additional funding. We're going to be launching some new initiatives here soon. But in terms of officially an ambassador, yes, it is a year-long program. But we're, like this year, for example, we invited all past ambassadors to attend a conference in DC and provided funding to make that happen. So we hope to continue to do that in the future, where once you graduate, you'll still be invited to certain events and you'll be part of newsletters that go out. And so you'll stay in the know of what the program is doing. Okay, and I'm not seeing any more questions, but I'll just pause here just for a second or two in case any more come through. Otherwise, I might just hand it back to Brittany. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you all so much for participating today. I'm really grateful to have had your voices and to heard about your experiences. One of the things that I really want to emphasize is that the STEM Ambassadors program is for all educators. And Eric, this was something that you and I discussed a little bit. And for NCWIT especially, one thing we're interested in is counselors, right? So if you are a school counselor or Eric, maybe could you talk a little bit more about what it means to be an educator as it comes to the STEM Ambassador program?
Yeah, we certainly approach that term in the broadest sense possible, right? There is no requirement that you have that you're in the classroom with students. I will say a majority of the ambassadors are, but for example, Lisa is not. She's a director of STEM programs at her district. So, and part of the cool thing that happens when there's these different roles or responsibilities tied to education, whether in a counseling position or some other position, is that it brings different perspectives, right? So those conversations that happen, the times you're able to collaborate, you're able to sort of make those connections and maybe new exciting things kind of happen because not everyone's doing the same thing, right? So just want to reiterate that. That's a great question, that if you're tied to education, you work with the teachers, you work with students, and maybe not a traditional classroom teacher role, We certainly would value your contribution and you can bring a lot to the program.
Thank you. And we got one more question that I just want to lift up because you did mention that there's an ambassador in Germany right now. Can Pacific Islanders and US territories also apply for the DoD STEM Ambassadors program?
Yes. So I saw Stephanie would like to answer. So the answer is yes. And I've gotten that question previously as well, this sort of application round. So yes.
Great, thank you. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you everyone for your participation in this webinar and for joining us and rocking with us today. We really value you and are appreciative that you're here. If you have questions about NCWIT's STEM Ambassadors program, please feel free to email me. I am happy to give you more information as much as I can or try to hunt down some answers for you. Also, please be on the lookout for an evaluation from our NCWIT internal evaluation team. These evaluations help to inform the offerings and the programs that we put out. And so we would really appreciate getting your feedback. As Stephanie mentioned in the chat, we will share this recording and share some follow-up resources so you can tune into your inbox for that. And if nothing else, thanks. You can go. Bye.
Have a great evening.
Thanks, everyone.